So let's move forward and start talking about temperature. Now, temperature is critical because it helps sell the feel of an explosion because it's emitting all that light and energy. So we want to be able to have a lot more control with this, and we want to be able to control it through cascades. We're going to introduce some things called dynamic parameters. So to start off, I'm going to just kind of zoom back really quick on our canvas. Right now, we've got the density that's up here in the top. I'm going to be working in this area right here where I'm marquee selecting on the canvas, and this is going to be where our temperature is going to be placed. To start, let's go ahead and just take one of our particle sub-UV texture samples. Let's duplicate that with Control W, and let's go ahead and just move it down here. Now, we've been working with scalar parameters, which, remember, are just single floating point decimals. We want to be able to do red, green, and blue controls with a parameter as well, and that's called a vector parameter. Let's go hold down V on the keyboard to bring one in. And for the default value, let's just set this to 1, 1, and 1 on red, green, and blue. Let's give it a name. Let's call this our temperature underscore color param. And to keep this organized, remember we created a group before for all the density objects. Let's go ahead and create a new one and call this our temperature. Now let's go ahead and multiply this. So what we're going to be able to do is inside the instance, we're going to be able to control the color of the explosion itself. So let's do the green channel of our particle sub-UV. Remember, the green channel is our temperature. Red was density, excuse me. Green is temperature. And let's do the red, green, and blue of the parameter. So if we right-click and do preview node on mesh, we'll see that this isn't horribly impressive yet, but we'll go ahead and fix this just in a second. But for now, let's go ahead and add this in with our density. So I'm going to hold down A and click. I want to take the initial result here that's already going to emissive. Let's go ahead and just redrag that from our add so that this add result now is going to go directly into emissive. For either input, it doesn't matter which order for add, but for A, I'm going to do density and then B, temperature. And it's there. It's kind of hard to see, but we can see now that there's a lot of white that's being added in here. Now, for an explosion, you know, typically explosions are going to be have lots of orange and yellow and a little bit of deep reds in them. So by default, we can tell this parameter to be a little more red and a lot more brighter, so it really sells that explosion automatically. And then if we want to change the color, we can go ahead and change that in the instance. So let's just change these default values here. Let's do 16 on red, 2.6 on green, and 0.8 on blue. So what's cool now is that since we're going to super white values, we're activating the bloom. So we can see where the temperature is hottest, we're actually getting a nice glow to it. What's also really cool is that even though this is primarily a red value, we've got 16 on red, since it's being bloomed, it's going more towards white, which is turning it towards yellow. So we're automatically getting cool values that are going from yellow in the really hot spots, and then we're getting a little more darker orange in the lower value spots. So the bloom's doing all this for us automatically just by multiplying it from this parameter. So that's really cool. Let's go ahead and compile this, and let's take a look at our instance editor really quick. Now, instead of density being the only parameter group, we have temperature as well. So let's go ahead and minimize that and take our temperature. And just to highlight what this can do, we can go ahead and click this to override, and let's turn blue to like 20 or something like that. So now we can see it's gone away from that orange, and now we've got that kind of, I guess, plum or lavender color. I don't know what you would call that, but it's definitely a lot more purplish. So let's keep going with this and see what kind of more controls we can add. So just like we did before with our density, we want to be able to have some contrast control as well. And contrast control is very key with the temperature because it's going to really help sell the feel of how thick this smoke is. The more contrast we add, it looks like the smoke is going to be so thick that it's absorbing the light so it doesn't scatter as much. So this is going to be a really key element to be able to fine-tune this. So just like we did before, we want a scalar parameter, so we're going to hold down S. We just want a single number to control this. Name, we're going to call this our temperature underscore contrast underscore param. Let's look for a power expression and dump that in. And before I forget, let's change the default value to 1, because right now, if we leave it at 0, our temperature is going to turn to pure white all across the board. It's going to look a little weird. So our particle sub-UV image, From the green channel going to base, our exponent's going to be our scalar parameter. And then let's go ahead and plug that power result into our multiply. And you know what? I also caught myself too. I did not set the group, so let's go ahead and change this to our temperature group for the scalar parameter. So this is what our material looks like so far as it's being added. Let's go ahead and just move this down and make a little more room because we're going to be growing a lot more to the right here. Let's go ahead and compile this. And let's take a look really quick. We can start adjusting this contrast parameter as well. Let's activate this. Let's change it to 2. Now you can see how it's disappearing a lot more, and you can see how it looks like it's having a hard time going through the cloud. And go to 3, it's gone even more. I think anything above 4 or 5 is a little overkill, but this is like a really, really thick smoke. I think this would be really cool for like a magical element or something like that. So this gives you a lot of control and a lot of finesse. So let's go ahead and change this back to 1 for now. Let's go back to our material, and let's keep adding some more controls here. Now I want to be able, this, when I talk about temperature for an explosion, this is critical, and I want to be able to have control of how much this is going inside of the particle system, and I want to be able to control it through cascade, because right now these vector parameters and scalar parameters, they can be controlled, but when it comes to animating them over time, it becomes a little more difficult. We could do it with something like with Matinee and a material instance actor, but that becomes cumbersome, right? Because you're doing it outside of Matinee, or outside of cascade, excuse me, and it'd be hard to preview it. I want to be able to have a module that I can do like a constant curve and animate it over time. So to do that, we've used things in the past called dynamic parameters, and we're going to use the same thing in this tutorial as well. So let's pull back this particle sub UV texture sample. Let's search for dynamic. And this will bring us our dynamic parameter. Let's just go ahead and drop it in. And if you've watched my tutorials before, you definitely know how to use this. I use this pretty much in everything I do. But a dynamic parameter is just an extra set of options that you can pipe through cascade, and we can control it over time. We also can do it just as a constant value as well. What's cool about this is it just gives us that level of control that we want. So let's multiply one of these parameters against our image here, our temperature, which is our green channel. In this case, I'm going to use the red, or parameter 1. And let's take that into our power base over here. Now we can keep this organized too. We can name these parameters so we know what they're doing. So we're going to be reusing this a couple times actually just in this section. So let's go ahead and call this our temperature control. So let's go ahead and compile this. If we look inside the instance editor, there is no new vector parameter or any kind of parameter that we can control now with this. This is controlled strictly through cascade. So let's go into the content browser. I'm going to sneak over here outside the capture window. Go into particles part 11 and let's open up our tester. And to control this, what we have to do is create something called a dynamic parameter module. So we're going to right click. I'm going to go to parameter. It's just on the bottom of my capture monitor, but we're going to go to dynamic right here. Now what we've seen right away is that it disappears. And the reason for that is when you add a dynamic module, the default values for all of these are going to be a value of 0. So if I go into 0, which is our temperature control, and one little neat trick, and I have to give a shout out to Mark Burgo for pointing this out, is right now this parameter name says none. I actually couldn't figure out why this always said none, but if you right click on the dynamic parameter module and do refresh module, it'll actually get the names that you've put from the material. So thanks again to Mark for pointing that out to me. But we can see that temperature control now, if we go to parameter value, is set to 0. So it's being multiplied out. Remember, we're multiplying this against our image. So anything times 0 is 0. So if I change this back to 1, now we can see this has been added back in. So to preview this a little better, let's go to our color over life. Let's just change this to pure black. I'm going to change it to constant. And now we can actually just look at strictly the temperature. I'm going to make the background color just slightly brighter too, so you can see the black particles against a slightly lighter background. So now we can take this dynamic parameter module, and we can have all the control we want with this. We can give it as little or as much temperature as we need. So if I change this to 0.1, you can see it's just barely there. It's very faint. If I can go to 0.01, it's even fainter, but it's still there. I can go to 2, and it's even brighter now. I can go to 10, and we're really going to activate the bloom. So now we can actually take this a step further, and we can start animating this over time. So let's say we can go to constant curve. Let's add 2 points here to our constant curve. Let's change this second point, 0.1. Let's do an in value of 1, and then leave that at 0. And let's go ahead and graph this so we can look at it. I'm going to remove everything except the temperature control here in the graph. Let's change this first point. Let's right click and let's do set value. Let's change this to 1. So now if I fit this into the graph view, we can see is that as I move the points around, it's adjusting not only how bright it is, but when it fades out. So I can tell this last point here to cut out right at about 0.5, which is halfway through. Now we can see as the particle gets through halfway of its lifetime, the temperature is completely faded out. We're left with just the density. So this gives us a lot of control. This is making it a really powerful material, and we can create lots of different explosions with this. Let's keep it going. Let's go a little further now. Let's go back to the material. And let's talk about how we can make this even a little more unique. If you've watched my tutorials before, I always talk about how repetition is one of the biggest visual enemies when it comes to effects. Because when you think about it, every particle is going through this exact same flipbook one by one. So it'd be easy for our eyes to be able to catch a pattern seeing the same images over and over. So I'm always looking for different ways of how to be able to get these to be a little more unique. Like when we did the flow map tutorial, that's one of the best ways I think we've ever done, right? Because we use these dynamic parameters and each one gets distorted at different values. So we can use a similar technique and we can hijack another one of these dynamic parameters to be a randomizer. So let's go ahead and do that. In this case, I'm going to use parameter 3, which is the blue one. And let's just go ahead and name this our randomizer. And what we're going to do is inside the dynamic parameter module in Cascade, is we're going to tell it to set a range, a min and max range, and it's going to stick with that range and multiply it against this curve or whatever we decide to set. So what that means is that every particle gets a slightly different value for the temperature control. We're going to reuse this a lot. We're going to reuse it in the opacity and the heat and so on, so that every element of this explosion gets a bit of randomization. So to get that, all we're going to do is just multiply the temperature control against the randomizer. So we'll take this red temperature control against the blue randomizer. We'll take this multiply result now and plug that into our other multiply, which is going against our texture sample. So again, we won't see any kind of difference in here. Right now it's 1 times 1, which is 1, so we're not seeing any kind of change. Let's go ahead and compile though and go back into Cascade and see what we can do. Now again, we've seen that the temperature has completely disappeared. Same issue as before, the default value here is always 0, so anything times 0 is 0, which is being canceled out. We can change this back to 1, so it brings it back in. Again, this could be another booster. We can change this to 10, it's going to boost it all up. But in this case, you know, we don't want just another multiply because that's wasteful. What we want to do is get that randomization. So I'm going to right-click again, use our little trick. Thanks again to Mark Burgo for showing me that. Refresh module, so it shows up as randomizer now. And what I want to do is change this parameter distribution to uniform. So now it's giving us a min and max value. So in this case, I can leave min to 0, and I'll change max to 1. So some particles are going to get totally canceled out because it's 0. Some are going to be exactly the same. And we're going to have a wide gamut of values in between 0 and 1. Now what's happening is there's a lot of crazy flickering, and it's picking a new value every cycle. It's going from between 0 and 1, and we get that stuttering. What we wanted to do is to say, hey, just stick with one value. So we can use this checkbox right here that says spawn time only. So now that we've done that, we can now see that it's sticking with that one value through the entire lifetime. And now we're getting a lot more randomization. We get varying values of temperature inside each particle. So this is with the randomizer on. Let's go ahead and set this to 1. Keep your eye on the particle system. This is with it off. We can see how much more uniform that looks now. So we can use this, and we're going to use this with a lot of the temperature erosion, which we're about to do here in a second. We can do it with our opacity. So this is going to really come into play to make this look sexy over time. So let's change this min value, let's just do 0.2, so that way every particle has just a little bit of temperature in there, so it's not totally getting canceled out. So let's keep moving forward, and let's do one last thing for this chapter to be able to get a little more control and uniqueness in there. And let's go back to the material, and if you've never watched the alpha erosion video, I know we've already talked about this, definitely watch the alpha erosion video on the MuFX site. It's free, it's 8 minutes long, and it's directly related to what we're about to do. And we're going to take the same principles of alpha erosion, and we're going to apply this to the temperature, so that as it fades out, so as we do this temperature control curve, it's going to subtract away, it's going to look like the temperature is being eaten away and kind of sucked in. So to do this, we're going to duplicate our dynamic parameter. We're going to use the same curve, so we're utilizing the same dynamic parameter again. Let's bring in our 1 minus, so hold down O on the keyboard and click. And let's plug our temperature control into this 1 minus. let's move our particle sub UV. Let's move this over here above the 1-. Now, again, really quick, if you haven't watched the video, the 1- is going to allow us to actually use the same standards for our alpha values. So 1 is going to be fully opaque, 0 is going to be completely transparent. If we don't invert this, what's going to end up happening is that we're going to have to work backwards, and it's going to be kind of confusing because we're not going to be able to see anything in the material editor as well. So we just do this as a convenience. So we want to subtract this now. So as our curve is falling inside of Cascade, it's being inverted. So it starts off at 1, let's say, so it gets inverted to 0. Maybe it gets halfway, so it's about roughly 0.5. Now it's being subtracted away from this image, and it's making it less bright. It's making it more dark. So there's less to add. Now the last thing we have to do is use that constant clamp, because we can keep subtracting and go into negative values, which is going to do some crazy looking things. So by clamping it, we're saying never go below 0, just stay at pure black, which means you're going to add nothing. Let's go ahead and dump that into our multiply now. And let's get a better idea of how this looks, because, you know, to do this math, it might be a little confusing. You might be saying, okay, well, you know, what's the difference? Why are we doing all this extra material work? Well, let's go ahead and show this really quick. So I'm going to construct my my sine wave previewer. If you've ever watched my other videos, I think I use this in every one. It's really handy. What this allows us to do is to have a quick previewer that's going between 0 and 1 inside of the material editor. So I'm going to search for a time expression. Time is going to go into the sine wave. And we're going to look for a constant bias scale. Right now, you can see it oscillating right here in the monitor in the expression preview. Right now, it's oscillating from 1 to negative 1. We don't want that. We want it 1 to 0. So constant bias scale is going to flip that. So let's plug this into two places. Let's plug this into our multiplier, which is going into our second temperature control parameter. So this is what it looks like now. Keep your eye like right around here where I'm circling the mouse. What you see is that the temperature is fading uniformly on all aspects. Let's go ahead and plug this into our erosion math right here, which is going right into our 1-. And watch how it changes. You can see now that it's being eaten away instead of fading, right? So this gives us a cooler dissolve approach to our temperature. And this makes it a little more realistic because it looks like there's just less light, so the scattering is reducing. So in the thicker parts right here, you don't see as much light anymore. So it just gives us that little sense of realism. Let's go ahead and hook up our dynamic parameters again. We'll keep the sine wave previewer around. This is something we'll probably utilize again. So I'm just going to move all three of these. Let's see if I got that last one. I did not. Might be zoomed out too much. There we go. Let's go ahead and just put these over to the left. So if we ever need them again, we can just kind of drag it and we don't have to rebuild this again. So you can see this is getting already a little more complicated. Let's go ahead and make a little more room. We're going to end up doing some stuff in the next chapter, which is going to take up a lot of room up here. Let's go ahead and compile this, and let's take a look at what's happening. You can now see that it's changed the type of dissolve because of that erosion here. Let's do this alpha curve. Let's actually get rid of it. So let's go back to our temperature control curve. I mistakenly call it the alpha curve. It's the temperature curve. Let's just change that to constant and set it to 1. So what we can do now is start adding a little more fine touches to it. And one thing I've been doing, and this is kind of wasteful because we're adding another multiply expression, but I think it really helps in this case, is that I'm going to remultiply at the very end, before it gets added with everything, I'm going to remultiply this whole result that we've done with our original image. So it's going to help kind of tone it down and prevent some of those really hard edges. The downside of this is that we've already got an expensive material that's building quickly. We're at 27 instructions, and we're going to make that 28 now. So it does come at a cost. I wouldn't say this is absolutely necessary, but it's good aesthetically because we're using such bright values here with our temperature color param. So I'm going to bring in a multiply. I've duplicated the particle sub-UV texture sample. Let's drag that multiply into our new multiply. And let's multiply now our texture color parameter multiply against just the green channel. So when we compile this now, we're going to see it gives this a lot more contrast to it. And it's going to be a lot softer of a dissolve or a fade towards the end here too. Again, you could tweak this with numbers with our instance parameters too to try to get something close to this. I don't want to say that this is totally necessary, but it's just something I've been doing that I like as well. So now we've got a lot of control here that with this. We can go ahead and boost up our contrast parameter to take a look at it really quick. We can see this is a really, really dense smoke, maybe 2 or something like that. We can go ahead and boost it if we want to as well. We can take this to like 100, get it really, really bright. So this has a lot of control. It's really cool. I'm going to go ahead and just change this back to 16. And we're going to end this chapter on this note, and we'll move on to the next one, and we'll start talking about how we can bring in some of the macro UV technology, or not technology, techniques that we've done in the material, and we can bring that into our temperature to give us some really cool internal motion. We'll see you in the next chapter.